Hello everyone, I welcome you to my YouTube channel Professor Civil Mandal. Here I speak about civil engineering and you will find my various video lectures regarding various topics of civil engineering over here. So this chapter known as the introduction of hydrology, or this is the actually the first chapter to the subject hydrology or engineering hydrology, which is very much popular in our BTech level and generally taught to the third year or fourth year students who are actually pursuing this BTech in civil engineering course, or if they are having some specializations related to the water resources or these hydrological subjects. So as I am saying that hydrology is one basic and important subject, you can say, in the water resources engineering sector of civil engineering, and that's why it's a very essential subject which one must know. And this subject is so important because it is one kind of a backbone to the water resource engineering, because this is the scientific study of the movement, distribution and management of water on Earth and other planets. So hydrology is not like that, it is only limited to the Earth and its hydrological process or the processes that are taking place on the Earth. It is also like if any other planet which has got water in it, you can say that hydrological process may go on there. Though it has not been technically proven till now that we are having some water or about or anything like that, like any usable water that is there in some other planet or not, but in our Earth, as we know, we have water, and this water continuously flows from one source to another through various forms. So this subject actually deals with the this flow of water or the circulation of water, and thus it includes the water cycle, the water resources and environmental watershed sustainability. So these are the things which we are actually dealing with hydrology. That is, we go through the water cycle, the processes that are prevalent in a water cycle, and even the water resources which we are dealing with during this cycle, and the environmental watershed sustainability, that what is the amount of water that we are sustaining in a particular watershed or a particular catchment or a particular basin. So these are the few terms which we generally come across when we are dealing with subjects like hydrology, and thus also you can say that it is a backbone of the water resources engineering, which is a sector of civil engineering. So the practitioner of hydrology is known as the hydrologist. So if you are asked that who is a hydrologist, you can say that a person who is a practitioner of hydrology is known as a hydrologist. It's quite simple. Secondly, the hydrological cycle is the next topic, and it is actually the very beginning thing which we must keep it in mind, and we must know that why we are dealing with subject like hydrology. And hydrological cycle is the very basic thing, very basic know-how that we must know when we are going for this hydrology subject, because whole of the process which are there in our hydrology, in our subject engineering hydrology, whatever we are going to read is actually based on, or it is just somehow the subtopics and some sub branches of whatever we are going to read in this hydrological cycle. So the hydrological cycle of the Earth is the sum total of all the process in which water moves from land and ocean surface to the atmosphere and back in the form of precipitation. So it is the sum total of all the processes in which water moves from land, ocean surface to the atmosphere and back in the form of precipitation. So in our childhood, which we used to learn about as the water cycle, like there will be some amount of water, it will be evaporated from a particular source due to the heating of the sun, and then after that evaporation it will condense to form clouds, and later on it will be coming as the precipitation, or it will be falling back on the Earth as precipitation. This was the simplest thing which we had learned in our childhood, back in our primary school days. But here we are actually learning why this thing is in a very big deal, and what are the total processes that we are coming through in our hydrological cycle. So it is the sum total of all the processes in which water moves. So first of the first thing is that the thing which moves is known as the water, and that's why it is the hydrological cycle. And just consider one thing, by the evaporation from a particular source, the source which we are taking, the thing which is getting evaporated, and it is condensing, and it is transported, and again it is falling down back as any kind of precipitation. So this is basically our water. So water is the only thing which is being circulated in various forms and various places, and we are telling it as a cycle because this process is continuous and is following one after the other. So the sum total of all processes in which water moves from the land and ocean surface to the atmosphere and back in the form of precipitation is known as our hydrological cycle. So now the hydrological cycle is dependent on various factors and is equally affected by oceans and land surfaces. So before we go to all the factors that we are depending on, which the hydrological cycle depends, or the keywords that are going to be affecting our course of study, let us first go through this diagram. It's a very basic diagram which we can see, like some source will be there where the evaporation will be taking place, and on this evaporation some clouds will be forming, and you can say here you can see the evaporation is in a larger amount, that is in the ocean, because more amount of surface water will be present in ocean, and this thing is getting evaporated to the atmosphere, and a condensation will take place where the evaporated form, which is in vapor, will come back to its original liquid state of water. So again then these clouds will be formed, and there is one process known as advection. Advection is the transport of bulk material. So any kind of transport of bulk material is known as advection. So in our hydrological cycle, here the advection means it is that transport of cloud from one place to another. Like you can see that cloud which is getting formed over here may be transported to here somewhere near the mountains. So we can say that this cloud will be getting transported, and it is through advection only, and this process is known as advection. And condensation can also take place over the land area, wherever any kind of evaporation will be seen, that same amount of water vapor which will be reaching to the atmosphere will cool down and do the process of condensation to form the clouds. So wherever there will be some evaporation, it will be followed by some amount of condensation. Again there you can see some other processes like sublimation and transpiration. So transpiration is basically the release of the water droplets after the photosynthesis of a particular plant. So you can see that this transpiration is coming out from any particular plant, and plants and trees and all from our vegetation. And this sublimation is the direct conversion of solid ice to vapor. So sometimes it happens in the glaciers mainly. The ice which is formed over the mountain surface, that directly heats up and converts to the vapor and goes to the atmosphere. So there we cannot say that it is any process of condensation or evaporation is taking place. It's directly the sublimation, where the solid ice or glacier directly changes into the liquid water vapor. So some amount of sublimation can be seen in the hilly and mountainous areas where we have glaciers. And finally, precipitation can be seen in two forms, one by rainfall and another like B. It can be a snowfall. So here you can see snow or ice is there, and few more things are there, like here is some surface runoff where the water will be running off from some higher altitude to a lower altitude. Because as you see that the drainage system what we are having in our landmass, like all the rivers which are flowing and whatever streams which are flowing, and even if there are some other sources from where you can see that water is flowing from one place to another, and this is mainly due to the change in the gradient of those particular two places. So from the higher gradient the water will be flowing to the lower gradient, and thus we will see there's a surface runoff taking place in that particular places wherever there will be see that you will see that water is running away. So some amount of water will also infiltrate and percolate through the to the ground storages, and that will be our groundwater discharge that will be coming from our groundwater. So there will be some groundwater storage forming due to this infiltration and percolation of the water that is there in our runoff or from the this our land water sources, whatever like lakes and rivers are there. So that percolation will be taking place, and that will thus become a recharge to our groundwater, which is basically our groundwater which what we drill and take out. And next is this groundwater can also be, just like our surface runoff, can discharge to some out in a lower place of some lower altitude. So this is known as our groundwater discharge. And also there will be some plant uptake. As you know, the plants will be taking up water through their roots for this photosynthesis. So this is known as our plant uptake. This is a diagrammatic view which you can see over here, that all those specific features are mentioned, and wherever the process is taking place, it is being leveled over there. So, but this thing can also be represented by a schematic diagram which is over here. So you can see that evapotranspiration, that includes both evaporation and transpiration, it is taking place in the atmospheric part and it is going upwards, right? See, the direction of arrow is somewhat upwards, and therefore we are getting evapotranspiration towards the upward direction. And similarly, we will have precipitation, it is the falling of the rainfall or snowfall, and it is in the downward direction, and both of these things happen in the atmosphere. Both this evapotranspiration and precipitation happen in the atmosphere. Next, this precipitation falls down to the ground surface, and we have an infiltration wherein the water that is being stored over the surface is actually percolating or going down to the groundwater, and that is our infiltration. And next is the unsaturated soil moisture, like the soil moisture will be there, and this unsaturated soil moisture will be forming, like it will be a mixture of the soil and water, and we will have some moisture in the soil. So this will be our unsaturated soil moisture, and thus it will count to our groundwater recharge, and it will thus then saturate the groundwater at certain level by filling up the soil or the ground, whatever is there beneath us, with water. And again, from the evapotranspiration and the precipitation, like we can see, two things will be occurring. One is the interception. Interception is that part where our plants will be just becoming an hindrance for the precipitation droplets to reach the surface of the earth. So before reaching to the surface of the earth, what will happen? Their leaves will actually come in between, and they actually will intercept the falling water droplets. Just the same thing which we see in the interception of a football match, like when one team is passing the ball to the other one, some of the opponent will come and will avoid that passing to happen, and that is known as an interception. So similarly, something similar will be taking place over here, that the interception is something like that, the water which was supposed to fall to the ground will not go to the ground, but will be intercepted by some plant, will be hindered by some plant or the plant leaves or branches, and it will be taken up by that particular plant. So that thing will not go to our groundwater recharge or to our surface runoff. Next is the overland flow, which is basically our surface runoff, and from the unsaturated soil moisture we can have our interflow that will happen in the soil base, and this will form the channel or network of streams. So this thing actually contributes for the formation of our streams or the channels or networks. Next, this thing will go towards as the base flow. Note the direction of the arrow, it is somehow shown in the wrong direction. It will be over here, it will be coming to here, that is to the base flow, and again it will go to saturate the groundwater, which will again all will go towards evapotranspiration. This is a schematic diagram of the same thing which we were studying over here. So the keywords which we did encounter over here in this particular hydrological cycle process. Let's start with the precipitation, and it is the water released from the clouds in the form of rain, freezing rain, sleet, snow or hail. And about this, the different types of precipitations we will come to know in the second chapter, that is the precipitation, where we will know about different types of precipitation that we are facing, we are having on our surface of earth. And it is a primary connection of in the water cycle that provides for the delivery of atmospheric water to the earth. So this is the main thing which actually delivers the atmospheric water to our earth surface. Next is the evaporation. It is a process by which the water changes from a liquid to a gas or vapor. So water which is present in our surfaces maybe, or in our lakes, ocean, or wherever it might be there, this water will change into liquid or gas or vapor, and it will travel upwards towards the atmosphere. So this is our evaporation. Evaporation is the primary pathway that water moves from the liquid state back into the hydrological cycle as the atmospheric vapor. So just as we know that precipitation is the primary way where the water will be coming from atmosphere to our earth surface, so similarly come to know that evaporation is the prime way, where other ways are also there like our transpiration or some other thing, but evaporation is the main way through which a huge amount of water will be transported, will be converted to water vapors, and they will be traveled upwards because they are in somehow light in weight. They will go upwards and form the condensation clouds. Next is the transpiration. It is a process of water movement through a plant and its evaporation from aerial parts such as leaves, stems and flowers. So this is a process of water movement through a plant and its evaporation from aerial parts such as leaves, stems and flowers. So this is the process which is particularly occurring in the plants, where they will release the excess amount of water as wastage which they are not requiring in for their purposes like photosynthesis. They will release that this particular water vapor, water through as a form of vapors from their stomatal openings, and this water vapor will again contribute for the condensation of clouds. So this is the one process where the water from earth, it goes back to the atmosphere, and that is our transpiration. Next is the infiltration. Infiltration is the process by which water on the ground surface enters the soil, and it is commonly used in both hydrology and soil sciences. The infiltration capacity is defined as the maximum rate of infiltration. So there's one process by which the water on the ground surface will enter into the soil. It will go underground, and this is known as our infiltration. And the infiltration capacity is something which we will know to denote how much infiltration is taking place, and it is defined as a maximum rate of infiltration. So whenever there will be some infiltration taking place, we can call that there will be some rate of infiltration by which that water will be percolating inside our soil. So that rate of infiltration which we are measuring, and that maximum rate of that thing will give us the infiltration capacity. So next is the condensation. It is a process by which water vapor in the air is changed into liquid water. So whenever the water vapor that is reaching to the atmospheric levels and it is converted into the liquid water, we call it as the condensation. And the condensation is crucial to the hydrological cycle because it's responsible for the formation of clouds. So for the formation of clouds, this condensation is very essential. And next is the runoff, that is mainly known as the surface runoff, also known as the overland flow, that which we read over here. So the surface runoff is the flow of water occurring on the ground surface when excess rainwater, storm water, melt water or other sources can no longer sufficiently rapidly infiltrate in the soil. So I'll tell you one thing over here. Whatever amount of water that is coming back to our earth surface, It's not like that whole of the water will go and percolate or infiltrate inside the soil. The soil has certain limit until which the water won't percolate. So that excess amount of water will be flowing off through various streams or over the surface, and it will be known as our surface runoff. So this excess rainwater or excess storm water or the melt water, whatever we are getting, like rainwater, storm water, melt water, whatever in excess we are having, this will actually flow off from some land which is higher to the land which is actually lower. So this is known as our surface runoff, and this will take place only on the surface of the ground. It will neither take place in the atmosphere nor in the underground sources. Next is the interception. It refers to the precipitation that does not reach the soil. So the precipitation which doesn't reach the soil is known as our interception, but is instead intercepted by the leaves, branches of plants and the forest floor. So mainly that amount of rain which is getting intercepted by our leaves and branches or the forest floor or the vegetation, which they are using for their own purposes and they are not allowing it to go to the ground or the ground levels or at the surface level. So this is known as our interception. Now to deal with the hydrological resources, we actually consider certain areas where we are going to study that particular process which we are considering. So we actually divide our areas in somewhat like called known as the catchment, and the catchment is a hydrological unit. A catchment area is a hydrological unit. So just as we know that you can say that one country is divided into states, and that states are divided into certain districts, and those districts form as the unit of administration, and from there we start our administration until we reach to the bigger level, to our central administration in our nation. So similarly, you can say that for whole of the hydrological processes which are occurring on the earth surface, we divide them into particular catchment areas, and that catchment area forms as one unit of that hydrological system. So that one hydrological unit is our that particular catchment area. So each drop of precipitation that falls into the catchment area eventually ends up in the same river going to the sea if it doesn't evaporate. However, it can take a very long time. So in general, what do we see? That whatever rain which is falling onto the surface, whatever precipitation that is occurring, that water will either get evaporated or it will be flowing through some surface runoff or through the sea, or it will go to our groundwater. So these are the only things that can happen to this particular precipitation, the water that is coming through precipitation. And eventually those water are seen to end up in a river, and thus this river in a process go to the sea. So whatever water is getting collected on the ground, that water is traveling, somehow making its path towards the rivers, and that particular river will somehow again make its path towards the sea, as we know. So this is the basic process which is occurring in every catchments of our every hydrological system. Catchment areas are separated from each other by watersheds. So separated, these catchment areas are separated from each other by some watersheds, and watershed is a natural division line along the highest point in an area. So basically mountain does this job to divide the particular catchments. So like in this figure you can see, wherever there is a rise in the land, like in this place or in this place or in this place, this if you consider that this is a particular catchment, this catchment is divided from some other catchment by this particular ridge or particular mountains which are over here. So again, the catchments are again divided into sub-catchments. So this catchment can also be further divided into sub-catchments, somehow more smaller units, also along the lines of elevation, and that thing can be done along the lines of elevation. And the drawing shows a theoretical catchment area with flow paths of precipitation. So the flow paths have also been represented, how this river, suppose this is a river, how this river will flow, and this is the process or the network of the streams that are forming due to the precipitation on the particular land. In topography, a drainage divide, water divide, ridge line, watershed or water parting or height of land is elevated terrain that separates the neighboring drainage basins. So what we know as the watershed, that is the natural division line along the highest point in an area. So what these natural division lines are caused from? These are caused from some drainage divide or some water divide, or simply we can call it a divide, ridge line, watershed, water parting or height of land. And it is these elevated surfaces actually divide our neighboring catchments or drainage basins. A watershed in an area of land that feeds all the water running under it and draining off it into a body of water. It combines the other watersheds to form a network of rivers and streams that progressively drain into the larger water areas. Topography determines the where and how the water flows. So the topography is the only thing that will be causing the flow of water. So wherever the slope will be there, whatever feature will be there, like some ridge is there, some gap is there, the water will make its path through it only. And thus the topography plays a very vital role to determine in which direction or in which way the water will flow. So the watershed in an area of land that feeds all the waters running under it and draining off it into a water into the body of water. Again, it combines with other watersheds to form a network of rivers and streams that progressively drain into larger water areas. So suppose if we pick up a country like India or USA, and we will see that there is a network of drainage, and mostly these catchments are divided into certain districts or certain states. So you can see that collectively, though there's one small network in a particular catchment, collectively they form the entire drainage system of that particular country. So this is the thing which is being described in this particular paragraph, that it combines with other watersheds to form a network of rivers and streams that progressively drain into the larger water areas. So now to know about whatever flow that is occurring or whatever storage is taking place or whatever flow of water or whatever inflow or outflow is taking place, we have this particular water budget equation. And this water budget equation is shown by this thing, that is P plus I equal to ET plus INF plus R plus delta S, where P is our precipitation and I is our irrigation, that is our inflow of water. So P and I are the inflow of water that is taking place in that particular river. Next is the evapotranspiration ET, INF is the infiltration of water, and R is the surface runoff or surface drainage. So R denotes our drainage, infiltration denotes our whatever is getting percolated, and ET is our evapotranspiration. So this denotes the total outflow of water that is taking place from the river. So P plus I is the total inflow of water, and ET plus INF plus R is the total outflow of water. And finally, this will result in some delta S, that is the change in the particular water storage of that particular river or area. So let's now go over through this particular question. So let's read the question first. A lake has a water surface elevation of 103.2 meters above datum. In a month, the lake receives an average inflow of 6 cumex, and in the same period, the outflow from the lake was 6.5 cumex. In the same month, that lake receives a precipitation of 145 mm and had an evaporation of 6.1 cm. Using the water budget equation, find the water surface elevation of the lake at the end of the month. The lake area is given as 5000 hectares, and let's assume that month has 30 days. So here we see that the inflows are given, that first is the 6 cumex of inflow is there, and we also have a precipitation of
145 mm. So we can write it somewhat like this, that the solution is somewhat like, solution is that the precipitation P is given by, precipitation P is given by 145 mm for one particular month. The precipitation is given 145 mm, and it is can be written as 0.145 if we convert that mm into meters, as our qmax are also given in, the inflows are also given in qmax, that is meter cube per second. So what we will do is that we will write the precipitation as also in terms of meter, so mm will be converted to 0.145 and it will become 0.145 meters. And if I multiply that particular area of the lake, that is 5000 hectares, and multiplying with 10 to the power 4 will give it in meter square. So total, if we have a certain depth of precipitation and that is 0.145, and the area of lake is given by 5000 times 10 to the power 4, and thus we can tell that this much volume of precipitation is taking place for that particular month, and that is equal to 725000 meter cube. So this is the precipitation that is taking place. Next, we will check the next thing, that is the infiltration, I, represented by I, infiltration. And infiltration is actually inflow. The inflow is the another inflow of water, that is the irrigation water that is coming to us, that is the 6 qmax. It is already in meter, so no worrying about that, but 6 meter cube per second. So what we will do is that we will multiply 60 for minute, multiply another 60 for hour, multiply 24 for a day, and multiply 30 for total month. So in total, what we will get, I is equal to 1,555,2000 meter cube. So this is also basically whatever we are getting in that particular month. So 6 meter cube is in 1 second. So if I multiply 60 with it, I'll get the total amount coming in a minute. Another 60 will give it for hours, multiplying 24 will give it for day, and 30 will give it for the whole month. So I will have total this much volume of water coming in as inflow. After we get the inflow, we will try to get the runoff that is taking place, and that is by the outflow of water, and that can be written as R equal to, it will be, R is given as 6.5 meter cube per second, Qmax is meter cube per second, 6.5 is our outflow, and as it is second, we will multiply 60, and it will be in hour, 24 for a day, and 30 for the month. So this is our runoff, and it will be equal to 305 1234 4 zeros. It is 1684 8000 meter cube. So this is my total runoff. ET is the evapotranspiration, or the, just as we don't have any transpiration over here, I'll just consider the evaporation part, and it is 6.1 centimeter, so it is 0.061 meters multiplied by the area of the lake, and that is 5000 times 10 to the power 4, and that will be equal to 305,000 meters cube. So this is the volume of evapotranspiration that will be taking place. So finally, I can say that the difference of inflow and outflow will be our storage, that is delta S. Inflow is equal to outflow plus delta S, or whatever equation we read, that is P plus I is equal to ET, the evapotranspiration, plus INF, the infiltration, plus R, the surface runoff, plus delta S, our storage. So P is given by 725. P was our 725 four zeros, 725 four zeros, plus I is 155 200, 155 200, plus it will be equal to 168 48 000, plus 305,000, plus delta S. This is our change in the storage. So delta S from this particular equation will be given by delta S equal to, on solving that I'll get 2904 meters cube, and this is in meter cube. So if I divide it in area, divide it with the area, 2900400 divided by 5000 multiplied by 10 to the power 4, that is our area of the lake, and thus I will get it equal to 0.05808 meter. So you can see that the delta S, as it is coming positive, so I will have this one as rise in the level. So there will be a change in the storage, and it will be a rise that by this much amount. So if this is the amount, therefore in question it is given that 103.2 meter level of water was there, you see in the question, and so from this the new water level, will be 103.2 plus 0.05808, and it is equal to 103.26 meters. So this is our answer to the question, and this is our new water level.
So I hope you are clear with the particular question, and this was our answer, that is 103.26 meter. So what we did, we had our flows in terms of Qmax, meter cube per second, and we had our precipitation or the evaporation in terms of centimeter or mm. So what we did, we just converted it in volumes as how anyhow we tried to do it. Like there was 6 meter cube per second was there, so 6 meter cube was for 1 second. So how much will you get for the next 60 seconds, that is for 1 minute, or for next 60 minutes, that is for 1 hour, for next 24 days for 24 hours for 1 day, and for next 30 days for that particular month. So that is how we got the volume of inflow, and similarly we got the volume of the runoff, and also that 145 mm was the height of the rainfall that was poured in that particular area. So if I multiply with the area of that lake, so that will give the volume of that particular precipitation that has occurred, and in suppose I convert the unit and it will be in some meter cube. So now similarly we did the same thing for evaporation, and now just by getting the volumes we could equate it, and thus the storage was available to us in terms of volumes. So availing that storage in terms of volume, we had to calculate what was the rise and which was actually given in meters. The question was given in meters regarding the elevation. So what we did, we converted that particular storage by dividing it to the area to get the amount of rise that will be occurring in that particular lake for that month. So adding it to the water level will get us the new water level. Next thing is the world water balance. So this, by this particular section we will know about what are the ratios of water, what are the amount of water, or what proportions do they share in respect to each other, the different sources of water, whatever proportions are there will be discussed over here. Like suppose about 71% of the earth is covered by water. We all know that most of the part of the earth is covered by water, and it is 71%. It is approx 71%. So the total volume of water in the earth is given by this, and 96.5% is the salt water amongst this, that is the oceans, and fresh water is the remaining 3.5%. So oceans take up the larger part, that is the 96.5%, and fresh water take the lesser part, that is the remaining 3.5%. And out of the fresh water, frozen is 69.7% and liquid is 30.3%. So frozen water will be 69%, frozen form the water will be available in 69.7%, and the liquid water will be available in 30.3%. So you can get one account that out of the 3.5% of fresh water, whatever we are having in the earth, that is suppose in earth we have 71% covered with water, and that is equal to 1386 million kilometer cube. And out of that 1386 million kilometer cube, 96.5% is taken up by the oceans, and 3.5% remaining is taken up by the fresh water. So out of that 3.5%, again it is divided to 69.7 and 30.3 amongst the frozen and liquid respectively. Frozen forms are our the glaciers and ice forms of water, whatever we are having it, and the 30.3% is the remaining liquid part available as fresh water, and that includes our streams, lakes and ponds or other sources like hot springs, etc. So this is a particular table which nicely describes the distribution of water, or you can say that the proper water balance is discussed in detail in this particular table. You can take a screenshot, or else the note will be available to you. The link for the notes is given in the description. You can check it and you can make a note of this particular thing. So till then, I hope this was the first chapter of the hydrology, engineering hydrology subject, and this was the introduction of the particular course where we discussed about the hydrological process, the various keywords related to it, and also we discussed about a catchment, we did the water budget equation and one numerical about it, and finally we concluded with the world water balance. So this was the all about the introduction to hydrology. So if you have any kinds of doubt, please do not hesitate to write it in the comment section, and also the notes are available. The link of the notes is given in the description. And also please like and share my video, subscribe to the channel if you are new. The subscription will help you for these various courses which I am trying to upload, and with this little help of subscription, just by pressing the button, you, whatever little help you are doing will actually boost my confidence, and I'll be able to bring some better videos. So that is the request. Please subscribe my videos. Thank you.